Integers that contains 1, 2, 3, 2, and 1. So I have all of these. If you're not strong with arrays, you want to kind of outline them just a little bit like this. You can write all over the exam, so don't worry about this. I'm going to put little index locations of each of these just so that I remember what we're doing. I also have V, and V is going to be a 1. And then I have a for each loop here. So for each int val in array. So I'm going to have a new variable called val. And it's going to contain one value at a time. And val starts with the beginning of the array. And it just loops through, just like you would with a regular for loop. So the very first one's going to be a 1. And then I'm just going to go through the check. So I have an if else, if v is greater than val, that's not true, right? Else, v minus equals. Minus equals means what?
Equal to itself minus values.
Yeah, so v equals itself minus val. So v equals 1 minus 1, which is going to be 0. And then we system.out.printf. Printf is going to be the formatted. We're going to pass in a string, but val is going to be here, and that's okay, because we can pass in something, and it can treat it as a string. It's going to automatically kind of handle that for us. Again, if I give you code, do not assume it does not compile. I will always tell you when it compiles or when it doesn't compile. If I haven't said this code doesn't compile on it, it does compile and it will run. There's no tricks. Every time I get somebody who writes, oh, this code doesn't compile, and I swear, it works. Just go with it. I know it's weird because there's a string here and there's whatever, but there's no tricks. So we have our val. It's going to be 1. So I'm going to print f 1. And this is really important. I have a print f, not a print ln, so I don't go to the next line. I'm going to stay on the same line. All right, then I loop back up. Val is going to change to 2, right? I move to the next item in my array. And then is 0 bigger than 2? No, so I do the same thing. 0, or v equals 0 minus 2, so I'm going to have a negative 2 here. And then down here, I'm going to come back down. I'm going to print val again. So I'm going to print 2 this time. And then I'm going to go back up, do the same thing. Val's going to change to 3. And then V greater than val, right? So you see the trend? Right, so I'm going to go all the way through. I'm basically going to have negative 2. Negative 2 minus negative 3 is going to be, or minus 3, 5. Right, and 2 here. And then with the 2, I'm going to do 1 here. So we do the last one. So when we system it out, after we finish this, we system it out, println, what's this? Empty string, right? So it just moves to the next line. So now I'm going to start printing here. And then I system.out.printf percent %d, which is a digit. And I'm going to print v this time. Was my v negative 7 or negative 8? Yeah, it was negative 8. We're keeping track of this, and then we're going to print negative 8 down here. And that's it, we're done. So these kind of questions are, you know, again, this is a little bit longer of a process than I'll have for your first question. I just want to make sure that you can trace through that much code. But there's partial credit. I want to make sure that you can get to both lines. It's important to know that, you know, printf prints on one line, system.out.println prints on the next line. Basic Java syntax, keeping track of variables, their values. And so you can write all of this up here if you want to, but down underneath, you'll want to make sure that's where you indicate that your output's here, or you can do something like this. I don't really care what you do. Just make it clear that this is not your output, but this is your output. So keep the two things very separate. Partial credit's great because it means I can take the question and break it down into points. And if you miss something, or if you put negative 7 here, for example, I don't have to mark the whole thing. Do you guys want to do this one, or somebody else want to walk us through this one? I brought swag. What? Want to do a harder one? We'll come back to this one when you're in the mood. Bless you. All right. All right, so who looked at the exam already and has questions about certain ones? I have something about a library. I have one about a letter generator. Anybody care? I've got one for UML.
Four.
This one?
Yes.
All right. So inevitably on all exams, I'm going to give you a bunch of code. This serves two purposes. One, you don't have to write all this code. And two, I know that you're able to trace through the code. And three, if I give you a bunch of code, I can ask you a couple questions on it. I can ask you what it prints and to draw a UML diagram for it. So you've looked at the same code and you can answer multiple questions on it, and that means it saves you some time. And we're gonna kind of reuse some of that code. So this is one of those example questions, a little bit lengthier, but so it says the following main method uses the generator interface and the abstract generator and letter generator. Classes on the following pages. What does it print out? So I'm asking a question about this, and we have a couple of classes in C, generator test that's here and a main method, that's what we're referring to. And then I keep scrolling and we've got a generator kind of class and an abstract generator kind of class, and then on the back, a letter generator class. This whole back situation, flipping back and forth, is not ideal, so I don't do this. It'll be on a separate piece of paper, so you'll have one sheet that you kind of refer to that's separate from your exam. But same kind of rules apply. So I'm going to look at this, and logically, if you're a Java developer, if you're seeing lots of code, you want to, like, mentally or physically, it doesn't matter, maybe draw a line between some of these classes. So I know that public class delineates one class, and I have open and closed curly braces. I can do that for the same thing. So I have a public interface with an open and closed curly brace. So I'm going to separate it. And then I have one down here. And so it makes things a little bit easier to kind of piece out. So I'm not looking at the entire sheet of code all at once. So for this question, we're looking for what does it print out? So that's the only question that's going to be here. And I want to kind of answer that on the other side. But I'm going to be tracing through this main method to sort through some of this stuff. So very first thing it does is and again, when I'm looking at some of this stuff, and especially when you can write on it, this is a great opportunity to start numbering things. So the first line I went to is here, so I'm going to put a 1 here just for my tracking purposes. I know the main runs my application, so I'm going to start inside of main. I'm not going to worry about any other code until I need it. So I have generator gen equals new letter generator, so I know I need to check out the generator class and letter generator. Letter generator seems to have a something that takes in a bunch of parameters. What does this imply? Constructor. So there's got to be a constructor somewhere for a letter generator. So in a letter generator, I noticed that generator was an interface. So inevitably, again, I'm always going to ask you to write a UML diagram. So we might as well do a little bit of it while we're debugging this, just to kind of keep track of what's going on inside of the class. So we're starting here in main, and I have something called generator test, so I'm going to go ahead and create a generator test. This isn't going to be a full UML diagram yet, because I don't need a full UML to trace their set of classes, but it helps me organize my thoughts a little bit. I've got a generator test with a public static main that takes in an args string array. Good practice. So my generator test is done. My handwriting is terrible, but this is why slides are good, because if you had to read this all semester, it'd be terrible. So I have a string array inside of my main. We're not really using in this case, but I need to note it anyway. And then I also need something for generator, so I'm gonna go ahead and create a generator. And this one, I noticed going down here, is an interface. So I'm going to go ahead and put a marker above it that says interface. then I'll create a box for it like I would any other class. Again, it's dangerous to draw the lines, but I have a pencil, so. All right, so generator test has a relationship with generator, but it also has a main method. So I want to use the most vague relationship. What relationship was that? It's harder without the thing, right?
That's terrible.
Yeah, just dependency. All right, so far we look pretty good. We have an interface for generator. I'm gonna have a next method. So I'll have a public next that returns a character and a public length that returns an int. And then since generator is an interface and I know that letter generator was what I was actually after inside of main, I'm gonna go until I find that. So I'm gonna go down to the next one and I found public abstract class abstract generator implements generator. All right, so I get an abstract generator. Handwriting. All right, and it implements generator. So that means that this class is gonna be, this class is gonna be our subclass, this class is gonna be our superclass. So I'm gonna go from here to there. So that means I'm gonna have this type of an arrow. And because generator is an interface, I'm going to use this dotted. And if you forgot about that, then the relationships are on another page on the exam. So if you forget about these, just switch to the page that has the UML description on it. But this one literally says interface on it, so that's pretty cool. All right, so we have the abstract generator, and I can add some things. So I'm also going to want a get value at. So I'm going to have a plus get value at sort of method, and it's going to take an int called index, and return a character. And it implements the next method, so I'm going to put plus next, and that returns a character. Great. And that's it for my abstract class. So I got the code kind of written. So I've got this UML diagram going for this. And now I finally got to letter generator. Public class letter generator extends abstract generator. So I have this extends relationship here. So I can go ahead and create another class. I'm gonna do it here just so that we can see it all in one space, letter generator. And a letter generator is just a regular class. It just said public class. So that's cool. And then letter generator is a type of abstract generator because it extends abstract generator. So I'm going to use this arrow kind of thing again. Same thing. But instead of a dotted line, because abstract generator is not an interface, I'm going to use the other one. And then letter generator has some stuff in it. I'm going to have, I have some private string variables, A, B, C. So I want to keep track of those. Anything I need to keep track of, I'm going to put in here so I can't see if I can do this. So I'll have A, B, and C as variables. This is the first time we've really had variables. So private A, private B, private C. They're all strings. And then I'll have a letter generator, which is a constructor. So I need to put constructor. Where we usually get in trouble. I'm gonna have a constructor, it needs to have the name, letter generator. And it takes in all the parameters. So it took in a X, Y, and Z. And it seems like it's taking X and putting it in A, Y, and a B, Z is gonna be saved into C. So X is a string and Y. This is why you don't draw the boxes first. You get the idea.
I think Z is an integer.
Z is an integer, sorry. Thank you. All right, we also had get value at, so I have a plus get value at. That takes in index, just like abstract generator, int, and it returns a character. And we also have length. So finally, we also have a public length. And so I know a few things without looking at the code anymore. Now that I have the UML diagram set up, if I did this right, then I have everything I need to be able to trace through things. So I know my main method. The main method, it was first creating a, it said generator, gen equals new letter generator. So I'm creating something that's a generator object, but it's specifically a letter generator. So I know that I'm gonna have an A, B, and C value. I know that when I call next for the generator, it's implemented here in abstract generator, so I know where to find that code. If I call length for the generator, I know that it's implemented in one of the subclasses, not here, but here. And if I call get value at, I know that it's not implemented here, it's actually gonna be implemented over here. So there's no code in this get value at over here, it was an abstract method. So just a way to kind of trace through some of our code. I don't know if I did that on this sample exam, but this is not, oh you did, yeah. So there's another question that says draw class diagram. So you would have answered a question by going through this exercise if it helps. So if you look at a bunch of code and you're not sure what it prints out, that bunch of code probably also has the draw UML. So skip to the UML first and maybe that'll help you understand. And if you get this bird's eye view of it and you have the code, it might be easier to trace through how to get through the code. So we have a bird's eye view. We have a pretty good idea now what's going on. I have a generator equals new letter generator, 1, 20, and 2. I'm gonna keep track of these values because it seems really important. I have A, B, and C over here in letter generator. So I'm gonna go ahead and say I'll just create like a little object over here for gen. Kind of like we used to do in some of the lower level classes, like create these little side things where we're keeping track of whatever. So I had in letter generator an A, B, and C. And I just wanna keep track of what they currently contain. They're all gonna be strings. So I'm passing in 1 in double quotes and 20. And the number 2, but in the constructor, we're passing in a number 2 and we're saying string.value of. So I'm going to actually convert that over to a string. So it's going to save 2 double quotes. This will be important for keeping track of everything for later, just so we kind of remember. And then the next line is string, so I'm going to go ahead and say t equals this. So I'm also going to kind of keep track of t over here as being space free. So you just have a space here, that's fine. All right, so the third line I'm going to look at is the for loop, for int I equals 0, so I'll keep track of I over here. I is going to be 0 first, and I is less than gen.length. I'm calling gen.length. Gen is the name of my generator. It's an object. It doesn't actually have an array list or anything, so the length is something I want to go check on. So gen.length. I need to find out what that is. So right now I'm going to go check on gen.length. I'm going to look at my flowchart here. I called it from here. I'm looking for length. Length's not implemented here. It's not implemented here, but it is implemented over here. So I'm going to go straight to letter generator. Look for the length method. It returns a.length. So whatever a.length is gonna be this. So gen.length, this value here, is gonna be 3, right? The number of letters that are inside of that string, the length of that string. So I know I'm going 0 to 3, or 0 less than 3. So the first one, if I equals 1, 2, 5, or 7, these are ors. Really just, you know, that's not gonna be the case. So else t equals what we currently already have stored, so no changes there. And I'm gonna system.out.println gen.next. So probably there were some other letters that we were kind of tracing through here, right? I wanted to keep track of, I checked here. Probably also wanted to check length. And then gen.next, that'll be the next thing that I actually go check on. So gen.next is gonna help me print my printed stuff. You know, I should probably put some that are cleaner. So, you know, you're gonna have a different space for this. I won't grab all the things under one page, but my print so far, I'll just put it back here. So far what I'm gonna do is print gen.next plus T. So T is gonna be space 3. I'm gonna call gen.next. Next is not implemented here, but it is an abstract generator. So I'm gonna look for abstract generator, go to next. So this will be call 8, you know, the line number 8. It's also keeping track of index. So I didn't really see index up here, it was hidden before. It's not on my UML diagram, but it's saying index plus plus get value at index minus 1. So I wanted to keep track of index. Index I can add to my abstract generator. Let's go ahead and add it over here. It's a private index called int. And so when I declare this private int index, what value is index storing to begin with?
Zero.
Zero, default. So index plus plus does what?
That one.
Now it's 1. Return, so I'm gonna go down here, I'm gonna do this. Return get value at index minus 1. So I'm gonna pass in a 0 to get value at. Get value at's not implemented here, it's gonna be implemented in letter generator. So I'm gonna pass a 0 in. I'm gonna jump over here to get value at. Remember my number 10. Numbering these just for the sake of it. So I'm gonna be passing in 0 as index. Now I want this dot a dot car at an index location. Car at was one of those string methods. So get the character at a certain location. Character at 0 is gonna be 0. So I'm gonna system.out.print 0, character 0, plus, which is gonna concatenate, space 3. So the very first thing I'm gonna do is 0, little 0, space 3. Put a lot of space between them so you can kind of see it. And then it's a print ln, so the next one's gonna move to the next line. And then that's the end of my for loop. So I'm done here, I'm gonna go back up, I'm gonna change I to the next thing, because I have I plus plus. So I is gonna be 1, I'm gonna do the whole thing all over again. I'm gonna do the whole thing all over again. Yes? No?
Question.
No?
I have a question.
Yeah.
If you want to upload this so we can review it as well.
Yeah, I can take a picture of this and throw it onto on Blackboard under exams or exam review or whatever I labeled that, I'll throw that on here as well. That's where this exam is kind of located. So you want to trace through the same thing. You're going to do the same thing for 1, but this time you're going to hit the if I equals 1 sort of situation. And you're gonna change your T back over and it's gonna print different things out, right? But you're basically iterating, you kind of already saw the end of it. You're basically gonna go through and every time you're gonna get a character from A and you're gonna change T just a little bit. You're gonna print them on the same one. So we're gonna put N here and then E here. The important thing is keeping track of all your variables in classes like this. So in the end, you're gonna have N here, which is a 4, and E here. And E is going to be with a 4 as well, right? Yeah. And then that's it. So you're not going to go through 20. 20 was a red herring. The other variable that we're kind of keeping track here. These kind of questions, it takes you a while to trace through. So if you find yourself tracing through it like 20 times, you're on the wrong path. I'm not going to make you do that. 3 letters is more than enough to go through this entire piece of code. But now, spending this much time on it, you've traced through this, answered this question for a decent amount of points, and created a UML diagram, maybe, or just a scrap, I'll give you scrap paper as well if you just want a really rough draft, the UML diagram, and you're sort of on your way to the next set of 20 points. So, good chunk of the exam is going to be, I give you a bunch of code, you got to trace through it a little bit. But you don't want to make any assumptions. You want to make sure that you're kind of looking at everything and kind of taking everything in stride, even if it looks like a lot of code all at once. You'll always have this little cheat sheet. So a good way to mark this up is obviously you want to start from the bottom and work your way upward. And then this is the is a type of section here. And these are has a kind of relationships, and then they get more vague kind of thing. The only time that we use this one is for main methods and for FXML. We'll have FXML this time around, but on the final exam, we'll throw FXML in as a requirement for your UML diagrams. So you'll have to be able to point to something that's an FXML sort of thing, but you don't enumerate anything for those values. Yes.
The lab?
Yep, it says it in the lab, in the rubric, under UML diagram, includes FXML.
Lies.
There's a date stamp on it. I can't change this stuff without telling you, I promise. It's kind of a lot. Right now, though, we're only doing a couple of things, so most of our UML diagrams, especially on exams, are going to be four kind of boxes at most. You know, we don't have lots of classes that we're kind of working on. Software engineering and further, you're going to have lots of boxes because there's going to be lots of different classes. So it gets to be kind of a bear to kind of create. Actually, your team project gives you a sample of that. So you have to create UML for your team project. And, you know, it's going to be big. So, you know, multiple people is a good thing. I forgot, I did get most of the proposals. If I haven't gotten your proposal for your team project yet, I will hunt you down pretty soon. I'll give you feedback if you have given it to me pretty soon. I'm not going to make drastic changes. I just want to make sure that you're inside of good parameters and it's actually feasible to finish by the end of the semester. So keep working on it. Keep doing what you're doing. Make sure that you're keeping contact. Maybe study for the exam a little bit. How about this one? So this question extends the last question. Get it? Extends. So suppose the first line in generator test main method is changed to generate a different type of generator. So this time, instead of creating a letter generator, it's saying generator gen equals new number generator. And we're still passing in three values, but these are all numeric. And it's asking you implement number generator class so that the main method prints out certain things. So hint, may either extend abstract generator or directly implement generator. So we're implementing a number generator class so that the main method prints out these values. You don't have to edit the main method. You shouldn't edit the main method because it's already going to work the way that you need to. You just need to implement the one class. So whenever we create, if I ask for a full Java program, it's going to mean a class and a main method in it, right? Something that runs the program. This time we're just asking for the class, so there's no need for a main method. I just need a declaration for a number generator. So let's start it out here. We have a public number, or wow, just said public class number generator. And in the hint, we're saying you can either extend abstract generator or implement generator. So let's look at our UML diagram one more time, so this makes things a little bit easier. So my goal is in my code right now, I have this main method. The main method creates a new generator of type letter generator. But now I'm going to create something called number generator. So it's basically going to replace this, but I'm still going to keep the rest of the infrastructure. So my number generator should look like which class? Should look like letter generator. Right? So I need pretty much the same thing. I'd really like it if my number generator did something like this. I'm going to go ahead and flesh it out here in UML first. So I'm going to have a number generator class of some sort. If it's gonna reflect letter generator, might as well have the same relationship, so I might as well do the same thing. Create another subclass of that same superclass. And then whatever letter generator did, I probably have to do for number generator. Now, we were given the same declaration, so I have a new number generator. This implies that it has a constructor on it, and the constructor is keeping, what kind of variables are these gonna be? Yeah, they're gonna be double values. So instead of having a bunch of strings, I'm gonna just create a bunch of doubles. So I'll go ahead and do that. I can say private, I'm gonna call them A, B, and C again, because bad code, might as well replicate it, right? And then they're all gonna be, in this case, types of doubles. Now this question is actually asking for code, but the UML diagram portion is going to ask you for that portion of the UML as well, so we might as well fill it in, and plus it helps us outline everything first. Get a number generator. It's not asking me for getters and setters, so if I don't, again, ask you specifically for getters and setters for something in an exam, don't write them out. It's a lot of writing for no reason. If you do write them out, I'll give you some extra credit. It's not going to be a lot. It's going to be a lot of writing. So what we do need, though, is a constructor, because this one had a constructor as well, so I need the constructor thing here. Constructor. My handwriting goals are pretty low, so I'm not expecting much from yours. No worries. X is going to be a double. And I can also pass, so I can call them pretty much the same things. I can say X, Y, and Z are going to be my parameters, so Y is going to be a double. And I've already spaced myself out here. Z is also going to be a double. So my constructor is defined. I'm probably also going to need these two things because they were requirements here. So I had get value at here, and then length was something that's already being called by main, and it's a requirement that's set up here in generator. So I need to follow through on all the requirements. If there's a requirement here that's not fulfilled, or a requirement here that's not fulfilled, I need to do it in the subclass. So I'm going to need a public get value at that takes in an index of an int. And you know, maybe we think about the return type on this one. So get value at, in this case, said character. So I'll go with character for now, but that'll be interesting in a number generator. And then length is pretty self-explanatory, and I'll have an int that it returns. Okay. So from this UML diagram, I have a pretty clear idea what my code needs to look like. I got public class number generator. I have this relationship here, which means what word do I need? Extends. So I'm going to look at the class after it, so abstract generator. If abstract generator is not an interface, I don't use the first word implements, I use extends. So it extends an abstract generator. And then I open my curly brace and I'll close it way the heck down here. All right, so I've created my class. So I need to implement the number generator class. I have three class variables that I've defined for this class, so I'm going to need a private double. They can all start out as zeros, right? The other ones were kind of, you know, whatever. So I can say double A, B, and C. And I use this cheat a lot. You can declare things that are the same type on the same line, but you can have them separate if you want to. It really doesn't matter. But we're declaring things. We're not setting them equal to anything or initializing them yet. I do need a constructor, so that's going to be the next item I want to go ahead and create. I'll create a public. Constructors are always public. I'm going to use these. This means private. This means constructors are always public, so they don't have public there, really. Public, the name of the class, number generator. And then it's going to pass in some things, so I'm going to have a double X, a double Y, and a double Z. And then I need to go back and look at my letter generator and its constructor. Because there's some important stuff that can happen when there's all this relationship kind of going on. So I need to make sure you know, if, for example, if letter generator called its parent constructor or the superclass constructor, so if it calls abstract generator's constructor, I would also need to do that if I'm extending that class. So I need to look at the other class, the one that I'm kind of emulating, to make sure that it's not calling it. It looks like all the constructor does is take in the values and then set them over to the other value. So I look pretty good. This is okay. So I'm going to go ahead and just assign the variables. I don't have to worry about the super word or calling the superclasses constructor. I can say this dot a equals x, this dot b equals y, and this dot c equals b. All right, so when I'm grading this kind of stuff, I always take this question and all the questions, break them down into pieces. So if there's something that you're not quite clear on, get the partial credit, please. Don't ever leave anything blank. I'm gonna go through and I'm gonna decide, like, this is worth something, and this is worth something, and this is worth something, and the assignments are worth something, and there's gonna be points kind of on the rubric for it. So if you kind of forgot about something, or you're like, I know I need to declare class variables, create this constructor, but then I'm not clear on what else I need to do, at least get the points for that. There's gonna be points for all these different pieces. All right, so I'm using this as a checklist. So I did all these things. I did the constructor, I need get value at, and I need length. So I'm gonna do get value at next, and get value at's probably gonna look just like the one in letter generator, to be honest. But in letter generator, we had it easy. We had public car, get value at, I pass an index, and I need the character at a certain location that I'm given. So I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna say public, and it's returning a character again, which may not be the greatest, but it's something. Get value at int index. All right, so I need to get, given a certain index, I need to get the value at the same location of A. And I know it's A because I saw the pattern when I was running the code. This is A in my letter generator. And if I look at the sample output for this one, 4457.2. So I need to basically just do that for my A that I'm also saving. But I need one letter kind of at a time. So how do I get the value at a certain character when my values are double? Yes. I like the cheats. So don't do a lot of math here. You can get cheeky and write the whole algorithm yourself if you want to, or you can save yourself like 10 minutes and say, I'm going to return something. Let's not do this all in one line so you can see how this kind of thing works. So I can do string, for example, string temp equals my A, this dot A, but I want to turn this dot A into a string, so I need to use a pencil, string dot value of A. And now I have a string, so now I can get the location of a character really easily. So I'm going to return temp dot, what's the method I need?